Hello, everybody. It seems like it's been a long time. It's been 2 weeks instead of 1 week. But welcome back. My name is Christopher DiPiazza, and we're going to be doing another paleo art demo today. We're going to be drawing another dinosaur. And this is a dinosaur that is present at both field station parks, both in New Jersey and in Kansas. And it's one that you guys voted on. And it's also a pretty popular dinosaur. But it's one of those dinosaurs, and we've done a couple of these already, that even though it's popular, a lot of people don't actually understand too much about it. So we're going to cover all that. No worries. So the dinosaur we're going to be talking about today is called Dilophosaurus, or Dilophosaurus. People pronounce it different ways. I say Dilophosaurus, though. So Dilophosaurus, here it is. And Dilophosaurus is really mostly made popular by the Jurassic Park movie. That is almost everybody's introduction to this dinosaur. It was also in the Jurassic Park book, which was written before the movie, but most people recognize it from the movie, including myself. So when the first Jurassic Park movie came out, I believe I was in kindergarten at the time, and I recognized my parents didn't let me watch the movie in the theaters. I only watched it on video cassette afterwards. For those of you who are younger, a video cassette is like a slightly less old kind of fossil. But anyway, so I recognized most of the dinosaurs in this movie. There was Brachiosaurus and T-Rex and Triceratops, but the one that I didn't know was this freaky dinosaur with these crests, and then when it got mad, this big frill popped out from behind its head, and then it spit poison. And that like blew my mind. And I was like obsessed with this dinosaur. I didn't know what to make of it. And I went to the library and I got these books about dinosaurs, and I found it. And I started reading about the Dilophosaurus, and I read about the crests and the teeth and all that, but I kept looking, waiting for them to talk about the frill and the poison, and they never talked about it. And I was like, who the heck wrote these books? Why wouldn't they talk about the frill or the poison? I'm so confused. Well, I learned, and many of you guys already know this, that the Dilophosaurus didn't have a frill. And there's absolutely no, evidence whatsoever that it spit any kind of poison. That's something that they made up. In the book, the author made up the poison part. It spit poison in the book as well. In the movie, they made up the frill part to make it more interesting looking. Maybe also, I believe it was to help differentiate it from the velociraptors. So, regardless, Dilophosaurus is still a cool animal. And we're going to draw what the real one looked like. And this toy is not too bad. This is made by Wild Safari. We've learned a couple things about Dilophosaurus since this toy was made. So I'm going to incorporate that into our drawing. So our drawing is going to be like top notch, as accurate as you can get. And let's see, can I access? I cannot see. Let's see, I cannot see the comments again. So I'm just letting you know. Let's see if I click on comments. Nope. I cannot see comments, and I'm not going to waste time, your time, trying to figure it out. So just know if you comment, and I'm not ignoring you, I just can't see it. I'll be able to read them afterwards, though. Okay, so let's get started. So here's my pencil, here's my paper. So Dilophosaurus. So Dilophosaurus had, here's the head, is going to be here. The neck, they had a pretty long neck for a dinosaur, and it was very much S-shaped, so that's the neck there. The chest is going to be here. The hips are going to be about here. I'm going to put one leg is going to be back here, like it's going to be running. The other leg is going to be right there. And the tail's going to be there. I believe the legs may have been a little bit shorter. There we go. That's better. Okay. And I'm going to flesh these out in a little bit. So that's kind of like our basic form. Now, again, I can't see the comments, but every single time I do this, somebody, maybe a new person who hasn't seen our videos before, always comments, slow down, you're going too fast, I can't keep up. And the thing is, I have to go at a certain pace because I only have an hour to finish this. So the cool thing is, you can just log into our Facebook page and watch it afterwards, or you can go onto YouTube. We'll post it on YouTube so you can pause it and rewind it and go as slow as you'd like. But for now, just do your best to keep pace with it. Okay, so great. And then I'm going to go into the chest, and the arms are going to be here, and the hands. Okay. So there's our Dilophosaurus so far. Now I'm going to go into the head. So Dilophosaurus had a weird head. Let's start with the eye. The eye is going to be there. The nostril is going to be about there. The mouth had like a notch in the front of it, and then it kind of went down again. And then, so it's kind of like a Spinosaurus mouth. To a degree. Okay. Now, the thing about it is it also had this crest on the head. Now, most of the time, and even in Jurassic Park, when they draw the crest, they draw it like a half circle and then like a little point sticking out of the back. And this is not new information, but the crest for Dilophosaurus has always been fragmentary. It was always kind of like broken when they found it, that it wasn't complete. So there was like a little part that stuck out of the back, and then there was like this part, and what people usually did is they just kind of filled in the blanks to smooth it out. But it could have been a very different shape than this. And this little back part likely wasn't that little pointy back part. This was actually likely part of a bigger structure. And again, this isn't new information. Scientists have always kind of known that the crest was incomplete. It's just that like the first artists who drew it chose to draw it this way, which wasn't necessarily wrong, I suppose. And then everybody else just kind of assumed that it was like that. It's called like a trope, and it just keeps going and going, and that kind of becomes the norm. But in reality, there actually was some freedom there. So I drew that shape to show you what like the typical shape, but we can change that. I'm not going to change it too much. I'm going to make it a little taller, and I'm going to round it out in the back there. And then it also had a second crest on the other side of the snout. So it's like a And that's what the name Dilophosaurus means. It means double-crested lizard or reptile. Saurus means lizard or reptile, depending on if you're talking Greek or Latin, I think. So that's how it got its name. The crests on this dinosaur, there's some debate about it, but it was likely some kind of display. They don't really look to be weapon-like. It's unlikely Dilophosaurus is running up to other animals and like hitting them in the head with the face. That doesn't seem very likely. They were probably for display. Maybe they had bright colors, maybe they didn't. Display adaptations don't always have bright colors on them. A lot of people like to make them bright. The toy here was painted with them red. Okay. Let's go to the eye. There, there's the pupil. There's our pupil. And note, I'm just doing the little black ring. I'm not coloring in the dot. And then I'm going to go into the teeth. Now, the Dilophosaurus had pretty nasty looking teeth. It had very long, sharp teeth in the front, pointed teeth. And then it had sharp, pointy teeth on the sides. These guys look to be more adapted for grabbing things and holding on with them. Not really for slicing as much, to my knowledge at least. Okay. Now, the other thing about this guy is it likely had at least what I drew here is like basically just like the skull with like skin wrapped around it. I'm gonna change that. I'm drawing it to show you what the teeth look like, but it likely had at least some of those teeth covered up by like a dinosaur version of lips. And we've talked about this before, with almost all of the dinosaurs that we've done. So that's a little better, and then I'll do the same thing on the bottom. Most land animals have some kind of, they're not true lips, but some kind of, we call it oral tissue, some kind of a covering over their teeth. Even that ones with big teeth, right? So like lions have big teeth, bears have big teeth. When their mouths are closed, you can't see those teeth. And if you want to go over animals that are more like a dinosaur, like reptiles, lizards, like the Komodo dragon, has huge teeth. And pythons have huge teeth. But you can't see the teeth on those guys when their mouths are closed. The only ones that you can are crocodiles. But crocodiles are, even though they're very closely related to dinosaurs, more so than lizards and snakes, they do very different things. They live very different lifestyles, mostly in the water. And their way their teeth are arranged in their skull, they kind of jut out a little bit ever so slightly, which supports the fact that they don't have anything covering those teeth. And you see that in some other prehistoric animals, like plesiosaurs, for instance. You guys know plesiosaurs or elasmosaurs. They have teeth like that, too, that kind of interlock. So they likely didn't have any lips. But dinosaur teeth don't do that. They don't stick out like that. They're kind of contained in like one shape, one under like the shape of the head. So they likely had some kind of a oral tissue over there. There's still some debate about this. And if I see other artists drawing their dinosaurs with the teeth sticking out, I don't try to correct them because they might be right. But I tend to do it this way for this reason. One of the cool things about paleo art is there's multiple ways to be right. People can do their own versions of things and they can both be right. All right, so here's the ear in the back. Now, Dilophosaurus didn't preserve any kind of feathers on its bones, but that doesn't mean it didn't have them. It just means that they wouldn't have preserved. So some people think it had feathers, some people think it didn't. I'm going to do it with some small feathers on the back of the head, maybe on the back. There we go. The neck would have been a little thicker in life. There would have been more meat behind the jaws here where the muscles would go. Some artists give them big, like jowly jaws sticking out all over the place. That's fine too. You can do that. They didn't necessarily have that much. They could have, I'm gonna keep it like this. But if you want to do them more jowly sticking out, you can. All right. Now we're going into the arms. Now, Dilophosaurus had three claws on each hand, and then it had a fourth finger that was much shorter. And it probably didn't really even stick out. Now, what's cool about Dilophosaurus's arms and hands is there's a Dilophosaurus fossil that showed that when the dinosaur was alive, it actually broke, I believe, its arm. Don't quote me on that, but I'm pretty sure it was the arm. It was either the arm or the hand. And it had healed over in life. So the break didn't happen after the dinosaur died. The break happened during the dinosaur's life, and it didn't kill the dinosaur. It actually healed over, and the dinosaur kept living. So these dinosaurs are pretty tough. I wonder why it broke. Did it get in a fight with another dinosaur? Did it fall? Did something fall on it? We may never know. All right, so there's the hands. So Dilophosaurus's arms were pretty long, but they weren't as long as like a velociraptor's. And their claws were pretty big, but they weren't as big as something like a Spinosaurus. Right, so here's gonna be the belly. Here's gonna be the knee, the calf, And then we're going to go into the foot. Here's the middle toe. Here's the outside toe, and the inside toe is going to be there. And then there would have been one more shorter toe, which we know from drawing our other dinosaurs. We can't see it from here. All right, and then I'm going to do the thing that I prefer to do on most of my dinosaurs, and I'm going to give it these like wide rectangular scales or scale-like structures on the feet. You don't have to put them on yours if you don't want to. There they are on the 1 foot there. But you can if you want. Some people, there's an argument trying to claim that a lot of dinosaurs wouldn't have had these. And that's because birds have these same scales. But when you see them on a bird, they're actually made of the same material as feathers, and they would have been from an ancestor that had feathers on that part. And they figure that out looking at embryos of chickens, which is pretty cool. But the thing is, a lot those kinds of scales are like that form, not biologically, not like under like a by material, but like the shape, that kind of thing that grows on an animal's skin in that shape pops up a lot of times in nature, not just in birds, in different ways. So alligators and crocodiles have things similar to that on their hands and feet. Some lizards have things similar to that. Even some mammals like armadillos have these like scaly structures on their hands and feet, and they're all to help them protect the feet when they run around in the brush from twigs and stuff. So there's no reason to think that, like, you know, why couldn't other kinds of dinosaurs have developed their own version of those scales? So you can put those scales on your dinosaur's feet if you like. And I'm gonna do the other foot. Here's the other shin, the ankle. This guy's gonna be in like a running position. So when birds, you know, which are living dinosaurs, run, they have the 3 feet on the ground, and when they pick up their foot, the two toes on the side tuck behind the middle toe, and they do this. So that when they pick their foot up, they don't go like that. They go like this. And you could watch like a chicken, or if you go to the zoo, like the ostrich or the emu do that. It's pretty cool. So I'm doing that here. I'm doing the toes are going to be behind the middle toe as this dinosaur lifts its foot up. I don't know if you guys knew this, but speaking of feet and Dilophosaurus, there are a lot of really cool dinosaur tracks from what we think was Dilophosaurus, or a dinosaur that was about the same size as Dilophosaurus, and at the same time as Dilophosaurus. And they're actually found on the East Coast, even in New Jersey. So there's actually quite a few dinosaur trackways in New Jersey from the late Triassic, early Jurassic. So it's like just younger than 200 million years old, a little younger than that. And there are some theropod dinosaur tracks in there. And judging by the size of the feet, these dinosaurs would have been about 20 feet long from nose to tail, which is the same size as Dilophosaurus. And even though Dilophosaurus bones were found in like the southwest United States, like Arizona, there's a chance that their range could have been much wider than that, and Dilophosaurus fits the time for these tracks. So these tracks are the same age about as the Dilophosaurus bones, which are found in another part of the country, and they're the same size as the adult Dilophosaurus tracks. So it might be Dilophosaurus. So we know Dilophosaurus lived in what is now the southwest United States. It may have also lived on the East Coast as well, or what's now the East Coast. And if it's not, it would have been a very similar dinosaur. And a lot of museums on the East Coast have tracks like this. A lot of New Jersey museums, like the Geology Museum at Rutgers University, has them. There's the Dinosaur Monument in Connecticut, which has them. There's a lot of tracks. All right, now we're going to go into the tail. Maybe we'll do some little wispy feathers on the end of the tail there. That's pretty cool. That's fun. Make a little swooshy tail.
Maybe it helped it keep bugs away, or maybe it was like a display to talk to other Dilophosaurus, or maybe it was like a distraction. I don't know, like to distract other animals. Although I don't know what would have been hunting a Dilophosaurus, at least not an adult Dilophosaurus. When Dilophosaurus was alive, it was the biggest predator of its community. So, we know T-Rex is like the, one of the biggest dinosaurs, meat-eating dinosaurs at least. But Dilophosaurus lives a lot earlier than T-Rex. So when Dilophosaurus, during this guy's time, it was actually the biggest, nastiest predator that we know of. All the other dinosaurs that lived with this guy would have been running away from it. It would have hunted all kinds of things that we know from that area. So there was like little crocodile relatives that lived back then that could like walk on land more easily and run around on their hind legs that Dilophosaurus might have eaten. There's a little plant-eating dinosaur called Scutellosaurus, which is actually an early relative of Stegosaurus and Ankylosaurus. That also it ran on its hind legs and had a really long tail, little bony armor over the whole thing. And then there were a lot of what we call sauropodomorphs, which are relatives of like Brontosaurus and Apatosaurus and Brachiosaurus, which were a bit smaller than like the giant ones that everyone's familiar with that would have coexisted with this guy. All right, so there's our Dilophosaurus looking pretty cool. And now we're going to add some paint. So I'm going to change up my station here, rotate my camera. Then I'm going to bring my water jug here and my paints. Let me open them. There we go. And my paintbrushes. Okay. Right, so for this dinosaur, I was thinking it would be pretty cool to do like some, how about orange? I think orange would be a cool color for this dinosaur. So I'm going to go with that. So I'm going to start with this brush, this like kind of small, medium-ish brush. I'm gonna get some orange and I'm gonna mix it with a little bit of red, make it a little bit more umbery. There we go. Gonna clean off my brush and then I'm gonna start painting it. And I'm gonna start at the nose. I'm going to go around the eye. I'm not going to paint the crests yet. I'm going to leave that for something else. So before that paint even dries on the crests, I'm going to use the water on my brush to just kind of smooth that out so it doesn't make this hard line. And then I'm going to go back to the body. I'm not going to paint the bottom of Dilophosaurus's body orange either. I'm going to leave that white. And I think we've learned before, we call it counter shading. I think we talked about it when we were painting Ankylosaurus. A lot of dinosaurs, or not, animals, have darker colors on the top of their body and lighter colors on the bottom. So I'm going to do that here. Now, if you're not using watercolor, you don't have to go in and blend the colors like I keep doing. I'm just doing that to make sure the paint doesn't dry with that like hard line. I want it to be nice and soft. So if you're using crayons or something, that's okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix more orange. This is more of a yellowy orange. And I'm just going to give it a little variety. So starting at the legs, it's going to be a more yellowy color. Go down to the feet. Here's the other leg. All right. Here's the start of the tail. Now, before, I was talking about how my only introduction to Dilophosaurus was in Jurassic Park initially. And it gave me a very wrong impression of this dinosaur, right? And I'm not the only one. To this day, well, recently, like when I used to work at the Academy of Natural Sciences in Philadelphia, I also used to work at the American Museum of Natural History in New York City, in their dinosaur halls, and I would be like, I was like a teacher there, And I would teach people about dinosaurs, and people would ask about Dilophosaurus all the time. Like, oh, wait, Dilophosaurus, that's the one that. And then I'd start to describe it to them, and no one had heard of it. I was like, Dilophosaurus. And they'd be like, what? And I'd say, Dilophosaurus has like, it's a meat eater from the Jurassic. It had the crests. Huh? And then I'd say, it's the one from Jurassic Park that spits poison. They'd be like, oh, I know that one. Everyone knows it for that scene, which is ironic because the reason why everyone knows this dinosaur is something that's not true at all to this dinosaur. So it's kind of bittersweet because, on the one hand, it's lame because the only reason why people know or care about this dinosaur is because it did something that was inaccurate in a movie, and many people who don't go into further into the paleontology field know the difference. A lot of people into their adulthood went on thinking that this dinosaur has a frill and spits poison. On the flip side of that coin is the positive, in that despite that, this is a dinosaur that no one would have ever heard of at all outside of the paleontology community if it hadn't been for Jurassic Park. I myself included, I probably would have learned about it eventually because I was obsessed with dinosaurs. But I learned about it and learned and made a point to go and educate myself about it as a kid in the library because I was obsessed with dinosaurs because of Jurassic Park. So it's kind of a good and bad. And I kind of feel that way about Jurassic Park in general. Some people like to bash on Jurassic Park, like, oh, it's wrong. I hate those movies. They're so terrible. The dinosaurs are all inaccurate. And they're right. The dinosaurs are not that accurate in those movies. But at the same time, they do, they're fun. They're entertaining. And B, they at least put animals, dinosaurs, on the map that many people outside of the paleontology community would never know. And that's education in itself. And Dilophosaurus is a perfect example of this. All right, so the orange has dried. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my thinner brush and I'm going to take a bright yellow. Beautiful, bright, sunny yellow, which is in direct contrast to my window right now because it's thundering and raining outside my house. So this is like protesting that, I suppose. And then I'm going to paint the edges of these crests bright yellow. There we go. And then I'm going to take the same brush and I'm going to smooth that out. Cool. Then I'm going to take like maybe, oh, how about blue? Let's give it blue eyes. That's cool. I don't think I've done a blue-eyed dinosaur before, at least for these. All right, I'm going to give it like bright bluish eyes, which is not impossible. That's not inaccurate. A lot of people do like yellow eyes. I tend to do a lot of brown-eyed dinosaurs or yellow eyes. But a lot of animals alive today, including the relatives of dinosaurs like birds and other kinds of reptiles, have all different colored eyes: blue, green, yellow, red. So I expect that dinosaurs had quite a bit of variety in their eye color too. Let's do the inside of the mouth a fun color as well. We always think of, animals as having like blue, sorry, like pink tongues or orangey red tongues. I'm gonna give this guy like a bluish black tongue. Because again, a lot of animals actually do have those colored tongues and mouths. So some reptiles have blue and black. There's even blue and black tongue. There's even a lizard that's literally called a blue tongue skink because it has a blue tongue. And there's other reptiles that have it too. A lot of snakes have black tongues. And a lot of birds have fun colored tongues too. Not just pink. Pink is a fun color on its own, but I guess it's just a common color for tongues. We kind of get desensitized to it. So that's kind of neat. I like a blue tongue dinosaur. I don't think we've done that yet together. All right, now I'm going to work on the markings of this dinosaur. I'm going to give this dinosaur some cool camouflage markings. Camouflage or maybe display, but either way, it's going to look really cool. So I'm going to mix black with a little bit of brown. Then I'm going to take this brush and I'm going to paint almost the entire top of this guy's head
in black. And I'm going to use like a rough texture on my brush against the yellow. There we go. That's better. I'm going to paint right over the orange. That's okay. Because the orange is going to be for other parts of the patterning. It's going to be like, I'm going to do like black and orange stripes. And this is inspired by some species of snakes. I used to work with some snakes called black-headed pythons. And they're native to Australia. And they had like orangey brown bodies and then a black head, like it suggests, the name suggests. And then they also had black bands across the body. Now, I'm going to go over this again with the black pen like I always do. So I'm not concerned about losing the detail because I'm going to go over it again with that black pen. And here's the other crest I'm going to do in this black color. There we go. Very cool. Ah, so dramatic. Here's what I got so far. Pretty cool. Not focusing. There we go. Okay. I'm going to keep going with this black marking thing going on here. I'm liking it. It's pretty cool. Now, if you don't like it, don't do it. We don't all have to do exactly the same thing, right? So, no one's stopping you. This is your painting, and you can do it however you like. End up having to go over it again. And I'm doing this, these brush strokes like this, because I'm inferring that there are feathers, like little short feathers. And I've taught you this trick before with, I think, the last dinosaur that we did, which was Therizinosaurus. So I didn't draw every individual feather on here, but by doing these little short brush strokes on the body, I'm implying that there are feathers there. And it's kind of letting the paint do its thing. I'm not really too concerned. See, this one's coming out a little bit more watery, but that's okay. Go around the knee. I'm still making sure my design is going along with the shape of the animal's body, though. So I'm not just drawing like a straight line stripe across the whole leg. I'm going with the leg. So the leg is turned, angled outward. I'm doing the stripes with the leg. I'll start at the opposite end, do the tail. Do some cool like bands. It looks like a lemur. And we're gonna meet perfectly with where I left off. And then I'll go down to the feet. I'll give this guy black feet as well. Or girl. Could be a female dinosaur. We don't know, since we don't have enough Dilophosaurus skeletons. We don't know if there is any kind of like variation between the crests between males and females. Some people have guessed that maybe since the crest could have been a display adaptation, that maybe the males had different shaped crests from the females. But we don't have enough Dilophosaurus skeletons, much less the skulls, to make that call. Maybe one day we'll find out. So you could say this is a boy or a girl. Male or female, rather, I should say. All right, I'll do the same thing with the hands. There we go. All right. So there's the basic color idea, color scheme, I could say, for our Dilophosaurus. It's pretty bright. I think this is contender for the brightest dinosaur we've ever done. I think the only one that came close was the Pachycephalosaurus, which was red and black and yellow. And the Therizinosaurus is pretty bright, too. It had, like, some red and blue on it. So that looks pretty cool. Yeah, let's move on to the shading. So I'm going to take my pencil again, and I'm going to start shading. I'm going to start on the inside of the mouth. I'm going to go way back in the mouth and make that the darkest. And then I'm going to shade over the tongue ever so slightly. I'm going to go down to the chin and shade it light. Now, since this is white down here, I'm not going to shade too dark, because it's not going to look right. So all I need is a little light shading with the pencil, and it comes right through. I'm going to do some squiggly lines that imply some shape here. I'm going to shade the bottom of the arm. I'm going to shade the underside of the other arm. The chest is going to get shaded here. There we go. Here's the underside of the other leg. Or the inside of the other leg, I should say. Bottom of the toes. Under the knee. Bottom side of this leg. Now those scales that I drew are scale-like structures, if you will. There's a lot of messy information about scales and the definition of what a scale truly is. So I always say scale-like structures. I'm going to trace over those in the pen later, so we didn't lose them. But yeah, so a little bit on that, if you feel like getting confused. Essentially, what I mean by when I made that remark about the scales not really being scales before is that the things that you see covering a snake or a lizard's body that we call scales are a completely different kind of body part as the things that you see covering an alligator's body. Even though they're both reptiles and they're both defined as having scaly skin, they're different structures. On a biology level, they're made of different stuff and they're formed differently. Well, they're made of the same stuff. They're both made of keratin, but they're formed differently. And furthermore, the stuff that you see on a bird's foot is also created differently when the bird is developing. And so the scales that are on a bird's foot are different from the scales that are on a snake and are different from the scales that are on an alligator. And all of them are also different from the scales that are on a fish. So scale isn't really a scientific word. You're allowed to call any of them scales. I call them all scales. It's just important to understand that, like, when you call something scales, you're not really defining it in any kind of scientific way. And if that seemed too confusing, that's okay, because it is confusing. Don't feel bad about it. It took me a while to figure it out, too. A lot of reading. All right, so there's the shading. Now let's move on to the background. So I'm going to take some, like, red and orange. There we go. Like some reddish soil, like almost like clay. The fossil tracks that we find from Dilophosaurus, or what we think is Dilophosaurus, are in rocks that are like that color, that dark brick red kind of color. So I'm going to make the earth that this dinosaur is walking on similar to that. So again, I'm not going to be too concerned about making it neat, because the ground isn't neat, right? The ground is not clean and tidy. It's the ground. It's messy. It's all over the place. Literally sometimes. I am going to be a little bit careful when I trace over the feet there. I don't want to get too much, but if it's okay if I do. Because, if this was real life, the dinosaur would probably have some mud on its feet anyway, right? In fact, you know what? I'm just going to put some over there. There. I did it. I painted over the feet. Some more here. All right, here we go. There we go. Then before it dries, I'm going to do this bit. And then the next part of the background, I'm going to do the sky. I'm not going to do any vegetation, trees in this one, like the green. You can if you'd like. There were certainly trees around. But I'm gonna imply this guy's like kind of like on a mud flat. This is like flat open mud for a long way around. Maybe it's hunting for like some fish that got beached or something. Who knows? But if you want to put yours in a forest, you can too, because there were definitely trees around back then. And Dilophosaurus probably was around trees too. So a very light blue. The Dilophosaurus's body kind of broke up the background into sections, right? So there's this one big section behind the tail. There we go. And then I'm gonna move on to this other section that's over the back. And then there's a little section under the legs too. Almost missed it. There we go. Okay. And I'm using a lot of water with my sky. I don't want it to be too dark. Oh, there we go. I don't know why I just saw the comment. That's so odd. I saw one comment. But anyway, just a reminder. I am actually going to be at Field Station Dinosaurs in August in New Jersey. And that's their opening day as well. So I'm going to be doing a old dinosaur art demo for all you. I did it last summer in July, and it was a lot of fun. We drew Hadrosaurus, which is the state dinosaur of New Jersey. We also drew Dryptosaurus, which is the other dinosaur that lived in what is now New Jersey. So I'll be there on August 15th drawing some dinosaurs. I will be wearing a mask over my face. And I will be standing at least 6 feet away from all of you because that is the safe thing to do. But I will be there. And maybe I'll see some of you guys there who are from New Jersey. All right. Okay, there we go. Cool. Then, let's shade. Yeah, okay. Then I'm going to take a little bit of dark blue and mix it with my ground color and make a shadow. The tail's going to go out that way. The head, the Dilophosaurus is running a little bit towards us. It's actually pretty similar to the pose that we did for the T-Rex. Not exactly the same, but it's kind of the same thing. There's only so many poses you can do with these dinosaurs in, right? I wasn't really even thinking about that. So the front of the shadow is going to be a little closer than the back of the shadow. All right. So there's, I'm going to show you our colors so far. There we go. And this part is pretty dry. This part's still wet. So I'm going to start on this end, and I'm going to start applying our black outline with our pen. Here's my pen. I'm going to start with the tip of the tail. Here's the bottom of the tail. Here's the base of the tail. The back of the leg. Here's the top of the hips. Here's the back. There's some little short, scraggly feathers there. There we go. Here's the arm. And let's see, what else can I do? This is still wet. Do the knee. The leg that goes down. One claw, two foot claws. There's a third foot claw just sticking out behind it. And then I'm going to do these that's those scale things that I was telling you about. There we go. The other leg. There's the toes. Scales there. Okay, great. All right, it's drying a little bit there. I'm gonna go into the eye, to the pupil. Now this pen is darker than the paint that I did, so I'm gonna get all the detail back that I lost when I did it in pencil and I painted over it in that black. There's the lower jaw. Teeth. There's the tongue that's kind of sitting on the bottom of the mouth. There's the top teeth that are just sticking out because the mouth is open. And here's the other crest. Okay, and then here's the top of the head, and here's the feathers that are behind it. The ear is about there. Here's the bottom of the neck. Here's the chest. The right arm The claws. And then we're going to do the left arm. Little folds of skin there. All right. I'm going to sign my name on the bottom. And then I'm actually going to go back in with the dark, the shadowy color again and redo that shadow because it's still not dark enough for me. So, I'm gonna go in here. There we go. That's a little better. Cool. Okay. And there's our Dilophosaurus. Oop, wait, I forgot to do the back of the leg. There we go. Great. Now it's ready, I think. Okay. Here we go. There's our Dilophosaurus. How cool is that? So, to bring it all together, Dilophosaurus, it's a meat-eating dinosaur. It lived during the early Jurassic, and it had these really interesting crests, two of them on the top of the snout that it might have used for display. It did not spit poison. It did not have a frill, but that doesn't mean it wasn't a cool dinosaur. It was also the biggest, most powerful, I guess you could say, predator of its community that we know of. So even though it's not like the biggest dinosaur, meat-eating dinosaur of all time, for its time, it was actually the biggest one. We'd call it an apex predator, I suppose. And even though its bones were found in southwest United States, like Arizona, we've also found evidence of this dinosaur in the form of tracks on the eastern part of the United States, including New Jersey. So I hope you guys had a lot of fun, and I hope you guys learned a lot about this really interesting meat-eating dinosaur. And I hope to see you guys next week. Again, I couldn't see the comments, I apologize. But I hope that maybe you put some requests down for a dinosaur for next week or a prehistoric animal from next week. All right, so I'll see you guys later. And I hope to see you at a Field Station Dinosaurs in New Jersey on opening day as well, August 15th.